Good afternoon. I hope you all had a good, healthy snack. They were only that kind of snack. I love meeting where people eat bananas. It's actually very childish. Well, now you all know that I'm on drugs. So that secret is out, thanks to my husband. I'm on a very expensive drug, so these are okay, right? And I do not have a Maserati. I do not dream of that. I'm here because I'm representing the Union for Affordable Cancer Treatment, UACT, a new organization. And I'm also here because I'm a patient, and I love to remind people here, all those eminent lawyers and professors, that there are some disturbing realities linked to your work. You all know that cancer has become, for some lucky few, a chronic disease. I am the daughter-in-law, sister-in-law, and myself a patient of a chronic disease. But we all know it's still the leading global cause of mortality. There's about 40 million new cases every year, 8.2 million deaths in 2012, and this is growing. We also know that patients with cancer live long life in some countries, very short life in others, and that even in industrialized countries like ours, drugs are increasingly too expensive, $9,000 every 3 weeks for me, and I'm a bargain, I heard. I get emails from people who read the UACT letters and tweets from people from all over the world asking me how to get access to drugs, how to get access to trials on drugs. That's a disturbing reality that you all have to remember. So how can we do better? How can a compulsory license improve access to life-saving drugs and cancer treatment in general? First, of course, we have to review existing mechanisms available to improve access to cancer medication, such as the mechanisms we've been talking about all day. So I'm very happy and very flattered to be invited to be the moderator for this short panel, but excellent panelist. Today, Professor Abbott will describe the international regulation, or rather the framework for regulating compulsory license, and Andrew Goldman will examine the statutory grounds for granting compulsory license in 13 industrialized countries, but I hope he won't talk about all of them in details. You have a handout. Our first speaker, who hardly needs introduction, is Fred Abbott. He's the Edward Balll Eminent Scholar, well-known and highly regarded for his scholarship and professional activities in international intellectual property policies. Professor Abbott has served as an expert advisor to a number of governments on matters of IPR, trade, and public health, among other related issues. I think I met Professor Abbott in Brazil 15 years ago, right? So we were very young then. Andrew Goldman is the Counsel for Policy and Legal Affairs at KEI, and he was already introduced, but for some of the people here, Andrew is working on domestic and international issues relating to IP, and especially compulsory license and requests of compulsory license on many different countries involving drugs for hepatitis and also cancer treatment. And it's my pleasure to invite Professor Abbott to the podium here. I think 10, 12 minutes. We can do it in 12 minutes.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here to speak with you today. And thank you, Jamie, for the invitation. I am tempted to think when Elon Musk gets to Mars and he asks, he will find that they all already know about Article 31 of the TRIPS Agreement. As Jamie mentioned at the very outset this morning, many of the people in this room or here earlier have worked on these issues for quite a few years with respect to developing countries, particular concerns about access to medicines. But one of the things we heard with the UN high-level panel on access to medicines was submissions, I would say notably, for example, from the government of the Netherlands to the effect of, well, yes, this may have been a developing country problem at one point, but the Netherlands can't afford to pay its medicines bill anymore. And we need to be looking at new mechanisms for dealing with these issues. And in terms of what I think is a fairly basic presentation I'm going to make in just a few minutes, when I have, over the past months, been contacted by members of Senate staff about various bills that are under consideration, it appears that there are two standard pushbacks. One is it is inconsistent with the TRIPS agreement, and the other is that it is a taking. Well, I won't try to address the second one at the moment, but the first one, I think usually these TRIPS agreement arguments can be fairly easily disposed of, but of course it depends on someone having at least a foundational knowledge of what's in the TRIPS agreement referring to these provisions. So I'm going to try briefly to go through the international regime that applies to compulsory licensing to demonstrate that this is a perfectly acceptable, legitimate mechanism under international law with a long pedigree and treaty-based permission for use. The first discussions that led to the final conclusion of the Paris Convention for the Protection of Industrial Property began at a conference organized in Vienna, Austria in 1873, and already, and this is Edith Penrose's definitive history of the Paris Convention, noted that at that conference, the most notable decision, which was a resolution recommended compulsory licensing of patents in cases in which the public interest should require it. Just to note that this isn't something that we thought of yesterday. The Paris Convention, when it was initially concluded and came into force in 1883, did not contain rules on compulsory licensing of patents or non-voluntary licenses. The main rules, although for those of you who are familiar with it, the convention is amended through conferences from time to time, but the main additions were made in 1925 at the Hague Conference. And they added details regarding in Article 5, 5A, introduced broad authority to address potential abuses from the use of patents. So that's expressly in the Paris Convention, and includes specific provisions with respect to cancellation of patents for non-working. And non-working is, unlike the general provision, is qualified by certain time limitations, 3 years from the date of grant or 4 years from the date of filing, whichever is the shorter for the provision on when you can grant the compulsory licensing. Now, toward Lake Geneva, for those of you who are familiar, the WIPO building is about 10 minutes walk from the old GATT building, today the WTO building up Rue de la Paix. And in 1986, of course, we started the GATT-Uruguay round negotiations to add substantive patent rules, which largely moved the center of IP gravity from WIPO to the new World Trade Organization. And in that respect, we had adopted the WTO ADRIPS agreement, Article 31 on non-voluntary patent licensing. Actually called, there's no use of the term compulsory licensing in the TRIPS agreement. It's other use without authorization of the right holder. And this provision, Article 31, covers both government use and private third-party licensing, and it lays out both substantive and procedural rules. If you are not familiar, it's very easy to find the text of the TRIPS agreement. Go to WTO.org and look under legal text and find the TRIPS agreement there very easily. I'm not going to go through in detail the specific provisions. I'll go through them generally in a minute. But in 2001, again, a number of us worked on this aspect of it. You had the Doha Declaration on the TRIPS Agreement on Public Health, which is an agreed interpretation of the TRIPS Agreement, and then that led to the 2003, August 30, 2003 waiver, and finally the 2005 amendment of Article 31B, adding Article 31B. Such a long-winded statement, I could hardly get it out of my mouth. But in any case, the Doha Declaration followed the confrontation in South Africa initiated by the U.S. and the EU and the 39 pharmaceutical companies, a consequence of the result of which was finally to confirm the government's rights to use TRIPS flexibilities. And this is an important general point without going into details. It's a main tenet of interpretation of the TRIPS agreement that governments have flexibility in their methodologies of implementation. So the TRIPS agreement rules are generally at a fairly high level of abstraction, and governments have a lot of leeway in how these are actually incorporated into national law. And the Doha Declaration provides that each member has the right to grant compulsory licenses and the freedom to determine the grounds upon which such licenses are granted. So quite literally, under the TRIPS agreement, a government can grant a compulsory license on the ground of its own choosing. There is no limitation on those grounds. And interestingly, one of the things that really brought everyone around to adopting this was the U.S. had for many years told other countries, don't issue compulsory licenses because it interferes with the revenues to the patent donors. And then as soon as we had a problem really meriting serious immediate attention, Tommy Thompson brought the executives from Bayer into his office and said, we're going to grant a compulsory license on Cipro and manufacture it here in the United States. And that was, other countries were somewhat surprised at this. Well, we've been dealing with AIDS here for a number of years. You've always said an issue of compulsory license. You've been dealing with this for about 2 weeks now, and suddenly granting compulsory licensing seems to be okay. That then led, following that, to the negotiation to overcome an obstacle potentially proposed by Article 31F of the TRIPS agreement regarding predominant licensing for export. If I went through the details of that, we'd be here all day. But the one interesting point to make out of that is that the U.S., USTR, opted out of the U.S. using this mechanism as an importer. I mean, we pretty much literally said if we have an emergency in the United States and a foreign country can provide us with the medicines under a compulsory license, we are not going to use it. I would like someone to explain that to me on a rational basis at some point, but we have agreed to that. So very briefly, running through the basic rules of Article 31, licenses are to be considered on their individual merits, but this doesn't mean you can't prescribe conditions under which the license would be granted, for example, based on the drug being an essential medicine or prescribed pursuant to a particular formulary, so you can have conditions. There should be prior negotiation for a voluntary license on reasonable terms and conditions within a reasonable time. But again, the statute and the government can prescribe presumptive time limitations on this to accelerate the process. Prior negotiation can be waived for public non-commercial use, emergencies, and extreme urgency. And for those of you who think the U.S. government may not have been familiar with its own 28 U.S.C. 1498 authority, in fact, there's some very, if you didn't know what that statute was, you'd wonder what screwy drafter drafted Article 31 of the TRIPS agreement. So you have to integrate 28 U.S.C. 1498 into Article 31B and paragraph 44.2 to really understand how we deliberately integrated the U.S. government's right to automatically take a compulsory license without prior negotiation, without notifying the patent owner, and without the possibility of an injunction, all actually got built in right into the terms of the TRIPS agreement. So we aren't violating the rules that we negotiated. There has to be adequate remuneration in the circumstance of the case, but again, that's a pretty flexible standard. The right has to be non-exclusive. In other words, you're not taking the patent use right away from the original patentee, termination of conditions when the conditions are no longer present. You have to have the review of the grant and remuneration by an independent authority available. So in other words, there has to be a route of appeal of the decisions, but it doesn't mean that the license can't function during the pendency of the appeal. So when you have either a compulsory license granted with respect to antitrust and in fact, with the new system, you have relaxation on the remuneration requirements. And in the TRIPS agreement, there's a specific provision that allows you to overcome blocking patents. So one thing that was mentioned this morning was that, well, the United States is basically an outlier in the area of its Patent Act. We're one of the few countries that doesn't have a specific provision for the grant of a compulsory license at the request of a third party. Although, as noted this morning, we have 28 U.S.C. 1498. And so if you read the guidebooks and the model statutes of the World Intellectual Property Organization, the World Bank, the WTO, the WHO, UNCTAD, and so forth, all recommend the incorporation of a specific set of rules within the National Patent Act to allow for compulsory licensing. At the very least, as Jamie alluded to before, they provide a background for other negotiations so that they provide some amelioration of the monopoly condition of the patent. Of course, in the United States, compulsory licensing is a judicial equitable remedy that's available. This isn't something that started with eBay. And this goes back further than this, but if you want to look at a major case in which compulsory license of patents was used, the General Electric antitrust cases back in the 1940s, in which compulsory license of GE patents was a broad remedy. I think all of our, or certainly the more recent of our bilateral and regional trade agreements all recognize the availability of compulsory licensing. They include them in various provisions, and they also recognize our acknowledgement of government's right to make use of patents as per the Doha Declaration. So this is just a very basic overview. I'm happy to answer any questions. And Jamie, I hope that that fulfills the charge that you gave me, and we'll. Thank you.
Okay. So I have very little time. This is a chart that was passed around. It's sort of a truncated version of a different chart that I'm looking at, but it basically has the grounds for compulsory licensing. My version has the decision makers for who gets to decide whether the compulsory license is granted, and also issues of remuneration. And this is for 13 different industrialized countries. So I'm going to try and get through this in about 5 minutes. At the outset, I'll just say that, you know, there's, as Fred was just saying, this, it's almost the limitless amount of possibilities for what a country can do with compulsory licensing. There's a lot here. I'm not going to go through all of it. You'll see it in a lot of these countries, there will be compulsory licensing possibilities for, you know, non-working or insufficient working of the patent. Sometimes you'll see compulsory licensing provisions for dependent patents, where you have one invention that has a patent and it also involves an earlier patent. So there's a problem there where you can get a compulsory license to go ahead and allow to do it, to work that. A lot of the countries in Europe have provisions about compulsory licensing for plant varieties, including a cross licensing, a mandatory compulsory license for cross licensing that came out of the EU directive. Having to do with biotech. I'm going to just quickly talk about some of the ones that are interesting as they might relate to health. And I think this is dry, but it helps set up the conversation that's coming in the next panel about what you know, as we think about the U.S. and what we might want to do, to look at what some other countries have done. So I'll just start with Australia. General compulsory licensing provision, you have to meet the three conditions. The first is a failure to obtain a license on reasonable terms within a reasonable period. The second is reasonable requirements of the public with respect to that patent invention have not been satisfied. The third, the patentee has given no satisfactory reason for failing to exploit the patent. B is an antitrust or competitive law issue. The reasonable requirements with the public is actually defined below, and it can include that the demand for the product is not reasonably met, which is defined below, to include that the manufacturer has not been done to an adequate extent, or that there's been a failure to supply on reasonable terms. Again, this topic of reasonable terms keeps coming up. Or in subsection 2, to supply the part on reasonable terms, and in 4, to grant licenses on reasonable terms. Australia has a crown use provision, which is basically government use, but for where there's a king or a queen. So I'm just going to go through this really fast. Just scroll down to Belgium. If you go down to Article 31 bis in Belgium, Belgium's interesting that they have a provision that is very specific to... Why is my scrolling? 31 bis. A little bit lower? Yeah, there we go. So Belgium has a provision that's very specific to medicine, which is, and there's not that many countries that actually have it, but this is really good. In the interest of public health, the king may, by a decree deliberated by in a council of ministers, grant a license to exploit and apply an invention covered by a patent for, you see, medicinal product, medical devices, diagnostic products, and so forth. So that's interesting. Canada, you can scroll down. Canada, the Attorney General of Canada, or any person interested, so again, this, you can think about the things that we've been talking about today, about who can actually try to get a compulsory license. The Attorney General of Canada, or any person interested, can try to get a compulsory license where there's been an abuse of the exclusive rights. Well, what does that mean? It's defined. To include that if the demand for the patented article in Canada is not being met to an adequate extent and on reasonable terms, again, reasonable terms, in subsection D, if there's been a refusal of the patentee to grant a license or licenses on reasonable terms, and so forth. So we can keep scrolling. In France, if you go down to Article L613-16, has a similar provision to Belgium that's very specific to medicines and diagnostics and so forth. If the interests of public health so require, the minister can grant ex officio licenses. So it doesn't even have to be, they can just do it. Specific to medicines, products, diagnostics, and so forth. There's sort of a specific limitation there having to do with the diagnostic products. So we can keep going. Germany, section 13, you can just look up here. There's a government use provision that the patent will have no effect if the federal government just orders the invention to be used in the interest of public welfare. So that's, I guess, it's sort of similar to 1498, but it's very differently worded. Section 24, this is compulsory licenses for refusal to license, and there's also for public interest. And this is the section that was used in the case last summer in Germany, where Merck received a compulsory license, actually, on patents having to do with an HIV medicine from a Japanese company. Are you able to follow along either on here or in your papers? I know this is really fast. I'm just trying to get through as much as possible. Italy, if you go down to Italy, they have compulsory licenses for lack of working, for dependent patents. They have that cross license that I was talking about for mandatory cross license for plant varieties. Also not included in Italy, I should note, it's kind of interesting, because you see that some of the other countries will specifically mention competition law, so like as a remedy for you know, violation of their competition law. Italy doesn't have that in here, but we know definitively that Italy's actually granted compulsory licenses. The anti-competitive, the competition authority in Italy has granted compulsory licenses on medicines, medical technologies. Japan, keep going. You can go get down to Article 93. Where the working of a patent invention is particularly necessary for the public interest. The Netherlands, again, public interest, Article 57. If our minister considers it in the public interest, you can get a compulsory license. Poland is interesting. Article 68, so actually, I'll work backwards. Article 82 has the general provisions for compulsory licensing. And in subsection 2, it includes where there's been an abuse of within the meaning of Article 68, so an abuse of the right. So Article 68 explains that. The patent holder or the licensee may not abuse his rights, in particular by preventing the invention from being exploited by a third party if such exploitation is necessary for the purpose of meeting home market demands and is particularly dictated by public interest considerations, and consumers are supplied with the product in insufficient quantity or of inadequate quality or at excessively high prices. I thought that was interesting just because you don't often see the explicit reference to the high prices, but that is very clear. Romania doesn't have a ton. when we worked on a compulsory licensing project in Romania, I believe we were working under Article 43.4c. They have the sort of traditional factors here or ways to get it, but we I think operated under the cases of public use for non-commercial purposes. Spain, you can go down to Spain. Again, you see the non-working, insufficient working, dependent patents, competition law, and then existence of public interest. In Article 95 for Spain, it explains the public interest. For reasons of public interest, the government may at any time grant that compulsory license. In paragraph 2, article, yeah, there we go. The grounds of public interest are where the initiation, increase, or generalization of the working of the invention or improvement of the conditions under which it is being worked are of paramount importance to public health or national defense. Public health, good. Sweden, Article 47 has a public interest. You can get a compulsory license if the public interest, if it's an issue of public interest of exceptional importance. And then the UK, which is the last one, has a kind of fascinating breakdown of the way that it addresses this stuff. It actually breaks the compulsory licensing, first of all, there's compulsory licensing provisions and then there's crown use provisions. The compulsory licensing provisions are broken down to whether the patent comes from a WTO proprietor, whether the owner of the patent is basically a WTO, within a WTO member, or other cases. And you can see the words, reasonable terms. Something is, if the demand is not being met on reasonable terms, that's under the on 48B. In 48A, again, the demand not being met on reasonable terms, and so forth. And then there's explicit reference to the UK competition law, if you keep going down. Thank you, Zach, for helping me. Competition law, 50A, and then the crown use provisions are under 55. So that was almost 5 minutes. So you know, I know that's a lot to absorb, and it's really fast. But the idea, I think, you can just to piggyback on what Professor Abbott was saying. There's a ton of different ways that. Sure. Do I have? Okay, I can try. Zach, can you go back up to the top? This is actually interesting to think about in the context of the discussion about Balll and what Jamie was saying about the problems that we perceive. You know, with Balll, it's the agency that you have to work with, right? And so that's been historically a problem. For Australia, it's that you apply to the federal court under the general compulsory licensing provision. The crown use provision, it's the Commonwealth or a state or a person authorized in writing. In Belgium, the general Article 31, good. Can you go back? Sorry. Okay. Okay. All right. Anyway, the general compulsory licensing provisions in. Yeah, a lot of the times. So, just as one example, in Belgium, and Belgium's is fascinating because they have certain provisions where it's the minister that's in charge of IP, I believe, that makes a decision, and then, like I was saying about the public health provision, that's the king makes that decision based on a deliberation of the Council of Ministers. But the general provisions in Belgium are first the minister and. And it's on application to the minister, and then if the terms of the license have not really been worked out, then it gets kicked up to a court, and so you know, different countries will do it differently. I mean, some countries, it's with the issues of remuneration, it's sort of the same. It's up to the parties to determine the remuneration, and then if they can't decide, you go to the court. In Canada, the compulsory licensing provisions are determined by the Commissioner of Patents. So it's, you know, it really varies. I think after this meeting, we'll try and, you know, circulate this chart online so you can see it in more detail, because I know the handout only has the grounds, I think. Let's see here. Yeah, in France, the application for the compulsory license goes to the Tribunal de Grande Instance. I should let the French. How was that? Tribunal de Grande Instance. The Supreme Court. they're all different, but it's interesting to think about the role of the court. I mean, just sort of imagining it in the Balll context, like what would happen if, you know, you could apply to something that wasn't so invested in and close to the industry. The remuneration issues, which are, I'll just sort of hit on one thing really, really fast. If you go up to Australia, I found this one the most interesting out of all of them. In the crown use, so you often in the countries will have, like I just said, they'll leave it to the parties to work out the remuneration, and if that doesn't work, then they'll take it to the court, and it'll be decided in the court. Australia's crown use provision actually allows for let me make sure I get this right. Yeah, when fixing the terms, the court may take into account any compensation that a person interested in the invention or the patent has received directly or indirectly for the invention from the relevant authority. That was sort of an unusual provision out of these countries, but I think I'm going to stop there. And if anybody has questions, which I hope you don't, trying to keep you awake before the last panel. Anyway, thank you.
I have a question of my own, but I can definitely wait, and I think it's more important to get the questions from the audience first. So anybody has a question for Professor Abbott or Andy Goldman?
What's the best compensation statute from a public health affordability perspective, that is?
Professor? Well, it's probably one that establishes some kind of remuneration guidelines in advance, but that will depend on the country and the circumstance, at least an outline of the factors that would be taken into consideration. For example, when you're dealing with low-income and low-middle-income countries, for example, Jamie did what's really, I think, been the definitive work on royalty guidelines for compulsory licensing in low-income countries for UNDP, I think, at the time. Canada, for example, in its CAMR system has a set of royalty guidelines. If you were in a developed country, I think you'd be needing to look at something more, I would think, circumstantially based. I mean, taking into account the costs and the reasonable rate of return and so forth. So I think, you know, you could have different situations with specific guidelines and factors that would go into the computation.
Yeah, I don't know that there's really a best one of the countries that I've looked at. I mean, I would agree with everything Professor Abbott said. I mean, some you see a lot of the same language in the statutes about you know, the courts taking into account the economic value of a license, language about things being just and reasonable. But I don't know that there's really a best one.
Has there been evidence of there being more liberal use of compulsory licensing depending on who the player is that makes that's the decision maker? For instance, if the authority resides in the Ministry of Health versus the Intellectual Property Office or what have you?
That's a really good question. I don't know the answer. I mean, like for example, the Germany case, that was the first time that Germany had ever used its provision in, under Section 24. So I don't know that there's really, there's no study that I'm aware of that I've seen that where that's they've done an analysis like that, but it's a good question.
Just a short clarification, I will ask Andrew first. In France, they changed the rule. Sorry, I have to bring it back to France, of course. Do you know if they added the language on the public health perspective after the BRAC test, which was a big deal in France? The BRAC test is the test to see if the genetic component of breast cancer. And I don't know if anybody here would know the answer to that, but I was wondering if there was a connection between the amendment of the law that you quoted and the actual creation of this diagnostic tool in the US, which was also a big case at the Supreme Court, right? So do you know the dates, for example? That would be helpful.
I don't remember the dates, but I think that's right. I think Belgium and France both, I think it was, they both came in at about the same time, and I think it did come after the BRAC issue. Is that right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think so.
So, and if there's no other question from the audience, I have a more general question, but it's...
2005 for Belgium.
Thank you, Google. I'll go back to that. It's a more general question. I come from the copyright world, much more than the patent world. And one of the big fight we always have with the European is that when it comes to exception to copyright, they have an exhaustive list. And they hate our system, which is a fair use system with a lot of limitation and exception to copyright. And I always try to convince my my colleagues there that sometimes less precision is better. But they don't believe that because there's definitely a kind of a lack of confidence in the courts in Europe. To go back to your idea of maybe moving things from NIH to the court, the European would be scared by that. But so I was wondering if, when it comes to this provision, Professor Abbott, or you would think that more detailed reason, more grounds, more deep down to what would cause a good reason to have a compulsory license is better than a very general provision, would say, like you presented, which is what the TRIP said, countries should do whatever they have to do, period. Or is this actually better in terms of the lawyer kind of a mind here?
Well, to be clear, the TRIPS agreement wasn't telling you what you should have in a statute. It was saying you can put in your statute what you would like to put into your statute. My tendency, and you know, this depends on the legal system and it's highly contextual, but I think that as a practical matter, a country is probably better off enumerating a variety of grounds because that gives the court a clear hook for what the legislature thinks would certainly be acceptable. But then one can always have a catch-all provision that says, and in the public interest. So when you say in the public interest, that makes things very open-ended, but that could be one of seven grounds on which to grant. And I think it's probably better in most systems to have some enumerated list of grounds because it gives the court more security or confidence or the administrator that the legislative body told us we could do X. If we go to the general public interest, we can extend that, but we're more comfortable knowing that we've already been told we can do X. So that would be my general response to that.
Yeah, I would completely agree. I mean, I think oftentimes we say that, you know, simple is better, but, you know, for example, if France and Belgium, you can see very clearly, like, there's something there about public health and medicine, right? So, like, you don't even have to argue about that or quibble. I mean, you could, and if you're a lawyer or if you're, you know, an NGO that's working on something, that's the one, you know, maybe you go to first. Like, it's I think, for all the reasons Professor Abbott said, yeah.
And I would like to briefly go back to the question that was raised by the gentleman from Public Citizen a minute ago. I think that as a general rule, there's been, of course, statutes often prescribe, at least among the parties that can authorize the grant of the compulsory license, the commissioner of patents. But that's a too restrictive formulation because, as in the United States, as in many countries, I mean, the patent office tends to be, on the whole, a more pro-patent body than other governmental bodies. So typically the preference would be, if I'm advising a government, is to extend the authority to the various ministries that might be responsible for the interest, so that the Minister of Health has the power to issue a license in the interest of public health, or more broadly. And I mean, many governments, and I would say even under our 28 U.S. you know, Section 1498, really make it a broad, it's an all-encompassing authority in the United States. It's not limited to a particular minister or ministry. So I think that's something you need to be cautious about in how you allocate that responsibility, and it would be something to even think of if one were looking at the U.S. Patent Act, right? Where would that authority vest in the first instance? Would it be with the, you know, Secretary of Health and Human Services, or would it reside in the, you know, the Commissioner of the Patent Office? And I think one would have to think about very carefully where you were residing that authority.
Well, thank you. Is there any question for the audience? So I would paraphrase or plagiarize or imitate Rob Weissman this morning when he said, it seems all solvable. It's just a question of political will. Let's do it.